Recorded Books presents Swanna in Love by Jennifer Belle. Narrated by Sophie Amoss. For my brother Matthew. People do not give it credence that a 14-year-old girl could leave home and go off in the wintertime to avenge her father's blood, but it did not seem so strange then. Although I will say, it did not happen every day. Charles Portis, True Grit. We fell in love. I knew it had to end. Bruce Springsteen, Hungry Heart. Chapter 1. There were two buses, one to New York and one to Boston. I got on the New York bus and sat next to Jackie Beller. She pointed out the window to someone's older brother. I just had SEC, she said, with that boy. It was so great. SEC was short for serious eye contact. It was one of our main goals all summer. He turned and caught us staring at him. I'm putting that on my list, she said. I don't ever want to forget it. The worst thing about being on this bus was that Labor Day was in 8 days, and then school would start, which was unimaginable. But that wasn't going to ruin the 2.5 hours that lay ahead of us. We had plans to take the love quiz in 17, make lists of things that happened at camp, and pass around our address books to get everyone's phone number. She had forced her mother to mail her the Weekly Wag, which was a New York City newspaper that had personal ads in the back. Like if a man saw a woman at a concert or in a street corner, but was too shy to ask her out. Or couldn't because she was with another man at the time, but he was sure she was the love of his life. He could put an ad searching for her in the back of the wag. We loved reading those. One of the male counselors got on with a clipboard and read off everyone's name who was supposed to be on the bus to New York.
Jacqueline Beller?
Here.
Nadim Adam?
Here.
He was from Istanbul, Turkey. And someone was going to pick him up at the bus stop and bring him straight to JFK.
Janie Rand?
Here.
Swanna Swain?
Here, I said. Then another counselor got on the bus and said something to him.
Oh, Swanna, you have to get off the bus, actually. Your parents are picking you up. Your mother called the office.
Not my mother, I said, confused. And a few people laughed, even though I hadn't meant to be funny. I'm one of those people who always gets a laugh for absolutely no reason.
Really, you have to get off the bus, the counselor said.
My father had moved out before camp started. Actually, last Christmas, which was one of the reasons I got to go to camp in the first place. So I knew there was no way they were picking me up together, unless I actually wasted my own time thinking they weren't going to go through with the divorce? I don't think my parents would do that, I said. They're separated. Even though my voice accidentally caught on the word separated, a few more people laughed.
Well, I guess it's just your mother coming, but you have to get off the bus.
My mother doesn't even know how to drive, I said. I hadn't heard from her the whole time I was there, although I had written to her once a week. At the address she had given me for the artist colony where she was spending the summer. The other reason I got to go to camp. I started to panic a little. My father would be at the bus stop waiting for me in New York. I didn't know what to do. I got up and walked to the front of the bus, intending to explain to the guy more privately that I would have to call my father first to check that I really was supposed to not come home. When I got to the front of the bus, I saw my bags had been removed from the luggage compartment underneath and placed on the grass. I'm really sure I'm supposed to be on this bus, I said. He showed me the little piece of scrap paper with someone's scrawled handwriting. Swanna Swain. Mother will pick up. Mother? Or father? I said.
The bus has to go, Swanna.
I tried to think if there was anything I especially needed in my duffel bags. My contact lens kit was in there, the saline solution, enzyme tablets, and the machine I needed to disinfect them.
But maybe I could just leave them there and stay on the bus and drive off without them. This sucks, I said. Again, people laughed as if I had my own personal live studio audience. Something told me I should stay on the bus. Just sit back in my seat next to Jackie and pretend I had narcolepsy or something. In 2.5 hours, I would be back in New York City. My father would be at the stop waiting for me. We would have dinner someplace great. Shakespeare's for a burger, or McBell's for a chicken pot pie. I liked McBell's, even though their salad dressing was a clear, thick, mucousy sauce with little red dots strangely suspended in it, and their bread had raisins in it. I wouldn't tell you to get off the bus if you weren't supposed to get off, the guy said. I'm going to stay on the bus because my mother doesn't know that my dad made special plans to pick me up, and when she comes, someone in the office can just tell her.
She is supposed to be on the bus, Jackie said. She was standing in the aisle.
I'm sure your parents communicated with each other, the man said.
I'm sure they didn't, I said. I started to head back to my seat, but the man literally grabbed my arm. He actually blocked my way and sort of forced me off the bus like an SS officer in Nazi Germany, and the doors closed in front of me. I just stood there holding Jackie's copy of the Weekly Wag. I watched the bus drive down the dirt road, past the infirmary and the tennis courts, until it was out of sight. I went to the office cabin to call my father, but the door was locked. I went to the phone booth on the porch of the canteen and dialed my father's number with a 0 in front of it. Collect call from Swanna, I told the operator. But the phone rang and he didn't pick up.
The party you are trying to reach is unavailable, the operator said after I forced her to try 3 times.
He was probably out buying some snacks for me to eat when I got home. I couldn't wait to pop open a tab. I never saw a place empty out so fast. Over the next 3 hours, the counselors, music and dance teachers, the entire staff hot-tailed it out of there. It was sad, like when you see a clown smoking a cigarette before the circus. Seeing camp empty kind of ruined it. There was not a scrap of food left on the entire campus. There had been one car in the parking lot, but when I came back from trying my father again, I was startled to see it gone. I sat on the grassy hill with a scowl on my face. I took off my high heels and laid them on the grass next to me. The leather on the heels was worn down. I had worn them every day the whole time I was there. I took my diary out of one of my duffel bags and tried to write, but the sentences came out too short and fast, like trying to talk between sobs. I looked at the Weekly Wag. Jackie and I had called one of the ads in the back. It was visiting day, and her parents took us both to dinner at the Red Lion Inn in Stockbridge, Massachusetts. They had a room there because they were making a weekend out of it. And while they were at the bar, we went up to the room and called the number in the ad from the hotel phone. A man answered.
Hi, I said. I'm calling about the ad you placed in the Wag. I think I might be the woman you're looking for.
You're kidding, he said,
sounding incredibly hopeful.
Well, I was in row C, seat 11, and I was wearing a brown suede jacket, and I have long blonde hair and aviator glasses, and I was with someone, I said, reading the details he had put in the ad. But I did definitely notice you.
I can't believe it, he said.
Jackie had her face plastered next to mine, trying to hear him. We talked for a while about how great the concert was. And then I could tell Jackie was starting to get nervous that the phone bill would be too big. And then I blew it. I pronounced John Prine like preen, and the man said,
What?
And I said it again. I just love John Prine. And the man said,
I think it's Prine. I've never heard anyone pronounce his name like preen.
And then I hung up. And Jackie and I laughed hysterically for about an hour. I couldn't wait to be in my own bed without the bottom of the upper bunk 12 inches above my face, coffin style. I wanted a 45-minute shower. When I first laid eyes on the bunks, I didn't think I could take it. I had never been claustrophobic, but the idea of us sleeping on top of each other like that reminded me of photos I'd seen of the Holocaust. I had a split second to claim one, top or bottom. Both seemed bad, but top seemed unimaginable, sleeping up there like a doll on a shelf. On the bottom, I imagined some girl's long hair hanging down ghoulishly as she peered over the edge of the top bunk. I took bottom because hoisting myself up there seemed impossible. Just the day before, our towels had been merrily hanging over the wooden porch railing, trying to dry. I couldn't even remember it now. I sat on the hill and flipped through the WAG. It came out every Wednesday and cost 75 cents. This one was dated August 11, and I had never paid any attention to the WAG, but Jackie said it was essential to get it, along with Backstage, every week, in case there were any auditions for kids. It also had something Jackie said was called a sex column. We didn't know why it was called that, since it just seemed to be by a sociology major, and the weird dates she went on with a man she called PhD, which stood for Pretty Hot Dad. Jackie and I couldn't believe how idiotic that sounded. I flipped through until I found her column. 10 Great Things About Dating a Man Who's 20 Years Older Than You by Mistress Amber. The heart wants what it wants, or else it does not care, is a famous quote from Emily Dickinson. Your boyfriend might not know who Emily Dickinson is, but I can assure you mine does, and that's refreshing. Daisy and Rhonda and I were sitting around talking about men yesterday, and they couldn't understand why I'd want to fall in love with a man twice my age. While they admit the boys they've been seeing are hopelessly immature, they still wonder what I could possibly see in my salt-and-pepper-haired scientist. I assure them he's not that old, but no matter what I do to convince them otherwise, they still see him as a cane-wielding, toothless elder. They don't know about his gorgeous eyes and magic tongue and great apartment. And of course, I'm the one using the cane. While Rhonda was buying her guy a Subway token because he lost his waiter job, and Daisy was on another Staten Island ferry date, PhD and I were dining at Café des Artistes and planning a jaunt to the Cape. No, Rhonda, he is not all wrinkly. He's 42, not 102. He might moan and groan once in a while, but only for the right reasons. And no, Daisy, I'm not worried if I marry him, he'll die and leave me a grieving widow. No one knows the future after all, and I look great in black. So, I have compiled a list to help you understand the many pros of dating my prof. 1. He has some money in his pocket. 2. His parents are dead. 3. He's busy with his children every other weekend. 4. You will always be so much sexier than his ex-wife. 5. He's an amazing lover, afraid of nothing, experienced, and unendingly grateful. 6. He can teach you how to do things, like sail a yacht and play tennis, or identify all the constellations in the sky. 7. He has read the classics. 8. He knows what he wants, and he won't waste your time. 9. He knows how to do his own laundry. 10. You don't have to worry he'll have a midlife crisis, because you are his midlife crisis. I put the paper down, because I didn't want to read anymore, even though it was pretty interesting. I couldn't help thinking about my father because he was 42, the same age as PhD. Also, my father was an astronomer and was constantly pointing out the constellations. I couldn't believe they would publish something like this in the newspaper, and I felt kind of sorry for Daisy and Rhonda, although those probably weren't their real names. To kill time, I went over to my cabin. The bare mattresses were particularly depressing. I felt like I was trespassing even though I had spent the last 6 weeks there. For a minute, I even wondered if I was in the wrong bunk. I went to the bathroom and drank some water from the sink using the last Dixie cup in the dispenser because I was dying of thirst. Then I walked over to the adjoining boys' ice hockey camp to see if the rink was open, but the doors were locked. It had never been locked before, but their buses home were even earlier than ours. Once, I had skated with Nestor Perez at night. He had borrowed hockey skates for me and laced them with my foot between his knees. I wasn't very good, but I just had to hold onto his arm, and I was skating. I had been hoping I could buy some chips or ringdings from the machines they had. I could see the machines through the glass doors, and also the big clock. It was after 2. The bus had left over 4 hours ago. My mother still wasn't here. I had to make a plan because I was sure she wasn't coming. Using the laminated Red Cross Level 6 advanced swimming card I had gotten for being able to swim all the way to the dock and back, I jimmied open the heavy glass door of the ice rink. I couldn't believe it worked. I bought a Coke and a bag of Fritos from the machines in the lobby, and I sat in the bleachers gulping them down. We had a vending machine in my ballet school, but they only had Tropicana orange, apple, and grapefruit juice. Once, I was drinking a grapefruit juice while I was putting on my toe shoes, and my teacher said, "Need a little sugar before class, Swanna?" in a very snide way. I always thought of that every time I saw a concession machine. I went to the payphone and dialed a 0 before the 212 and my father's number. "Operator, may I help you?" a woman said into the phone. "Collect from Swanna," I said. My dad didn't answer. After the phone rang 7 times, she said, "I'm not getting an answer, honey." I hung up and put my original dime back in my pocket. I decided to try again in a few minutes, so I went back into the rink and sat in the bleachers. It was quiet. I expected the boys to rush onto the ice at any moment like a raft of penguins, but I was alone. I had sat there a good part of the summer watching Nestor Perez wearing his jersey for extra warmth with Perez in black letters on my back. It was freezing in there. Watching ice hockey always made me feel like I was at the Penguin House at the Central Park Zoo or at the Coney Island Aquarium watching fish in a tank. It was quite aquatic. The boys tumbled and crashed and dodged each other, but very gracefully, like they were moving through water. And then the Zamboni would emerge like a blue whale from behind these car wash strips of clear plastic, causing the boys to dart and scatter like minnows. Everyone was very somber when the Zamboni surfaced. It was blue and had the name Olympia written on its side, and it felt like an appearance from a Greek god. I went back to the machine and put another quarter and a dime in the slot and got another bag of Fritos, making sure I still had a dime left to try calling my dad collect again. I sucked the salt off of each Frito and finished them with the last of my Coke. There was a table covered with lost and found items, and I went to see if any of them might be Nestor's, but they all smelled pretty bad, so I didn't spend too much time looking for name tags. I took a puck and picked up a pair of skates, went back to the bleachers, and slid them onto my bare feet. There were a lot of socks on the table, but there was no way I was going to touch them. I laced the skates as tightly as I could, took the yellow terry cloth tea cozies off the blades, and stepped onto the ice. I knew this was stupid. If I broke my leg, no one would find me. These were hockey skates, which were almost impossible to skate in. I bent my knees and leaned forward and started by marching the way Nestor had shown me. Then I began to glide. I skated all the way around the rink, sticking pretty closely to the wall. My ankles ached. I skated to the exact center and stood there for a few minutes, looking over to where I would normally be sitting top row center. If I hadn't been kicked off the bus and been abandoned here, I never would have gotten to know this feeling of standing all alone in the middle of the rink with my arms spread out and my head thrown back. That's how life always was. Something good could happen. I skated cautiously back to the rink door and stepped onto solid ground. I returned the skates to the table and tried calling collect one more time, but my dad wasn't home. He was probably frantically trying to figure out what to do, or maybe even driving up to get me. The bus I should have stayed on was already there, the kids on it already lying on their own beds, watching their own TVs. Nadim Adam had already boarded his flight to Istanbul. I went down to the lake because the lifeguards kept flavored ices that came in long plastic tubes in a big styrofoam cooler in the boathouse. But the cooler was empty. I would have killed for one of those ices. I went back to the hill where I had left my bags and sat down next to them. I had to decide what to do. I could wait to see if my father came to get me. The rule, if you were lost, was stay put. But if he thought my mother was coming, he wouldn't know anything was wrong. I could hitchhike to the Red Lion Inn, or all the way to New York. I had never hitchhiked before, and I knew it was dangerous. I would have to leave my duffel bags because there was no way I could carry them. I had to make a decision before it got dark. I lay back on the grassy hill and closed my eyes. I opened them to find my mother standing over me. Her hair was longer and blonder, and she looked very thin and good. Her legs were tanned, and her top was see-through, of course. "Come on," she said. "Get in the truck. I can't wait for you to meet Borislav." I didn't know which was more horrifying, the word truck or the word Borislav. "Do you want to see my bunk in the main stage theater?" I asked. "In the lake?" My mother inexplicably loved lakes. As soon as I said it, I regretted it, because my mother was probably going to attempt to skinny dip. "Actually, I just remembered we're not allowed in the lake," I said. "We really have to get on the road," she said. Chapter 2. My mother sat between me and the driver in the cab of the mint green truck. Being from New York, I didn't drive in cars that much, but whenever I did, I had a strange vision. I imagined ghosts lined up on both sides of the road, clutching each other's wrists, making a human chain, welcoming me to my death. It was terrifying, but comforting too, like a Coca-Cola commercial. "I'd like to teach the world to sing." That was seriously the thing I saw every time I got into a car in the country for some reason. I had no idea who the driver was. My mother didn't drive, so I figured she just hired the guy. The truck must be the country version of a taxi, and he was going to take us to the train. Or maybe take us all the way back to the city. "Borislav is an artist," my mother said. "He's Russian." "Interesting," I said. Our family believed in always being nice to cab drivers. I felt sorry for her that she had to be the one to sit next to him. "Where in Russia?"
"I was born here," he said.
He didn't sound Russian at all. "So when did you move to Russia?" "He's from New Jersey," my mother said. Could it be proudly? She put her hand on his jeans. "So he's not from Russia," I said. "This is what it's like having a daughter on the debate team," my mother said. She thought being on the debate team was one of the least attractive things about me. "Boys don't date girls who debate," she said. He was wearing white sweat socks with flip-flops. He had plumber's crack. I'd seen it when he lifted my duffels into the back of the truck, and I'd made a mental note not to look at him again. My mother was grinning. She was dressed in clothes I had never seen. Her top had bell bottoms for sleeves. It was 1982, but she had gotten dressed in the 70s. "Where are we going?" I asked. "We're going to pick up your brother." "Now?" I said. "How far is that? We're not going straight home?" I knew I sounded upset. I realized I hadn't really thought about my brother, although I had written him a lot of letters. I felt terrible that I didn't know how far apart our camps were. Suddenly, the man from New Jersey pulled over to the side of the road. He said. He spoke quietly, and I thought maybe he had said more and I'd somehow missed it.
Swanna?
He said. I didn't even know he knew my name.
"Yeah?"
I said, really starting to panic now.
I just want you to know something.
What? I said.
I just want you to know that I'm not trying to replace your father or anything like that.
I know, I said. I had never been more horrified in my entire life. I didn't even know who this person was. I couldn't even remember his name. I had no idea what he was talking about. Why are you telling me this? I looked to my mother for some kind of help, but she was still just grinning appreciatively at this moron. He finally started driving again, and I leaned against the door of the truck as hard as I could, hoping it would open and I would fall out. Then I would hitchhike to Camp Woods Lake and rescue my brother before he had to get the, "I'm not trying to replace your father" speech and get us back to New York. I felt so sorry for my brother that he was going to have to get this speech and ride in this truck. I'm starving, I said. I didn't eat all day. There was no food.
For all that money, you'd think they'd feed you.
You were 5 hours late. Everyone had to be picked up by 9.
I started writing a new poem, my mother said.
There's a gas station, the man said.
I have to call Dad, I said to my mother. As soon as the truck stopped, I got out and walked into the store. I had $7. I bought a large bag of Wise potato chips, ringdings, and a tab. I opened the ringdings and ate them both while I was still at the counter. My mother was the most selfish person on the face of the earth. I was supposed to already be home watching TV. Is there a phone? I asked the man behind the counter.
It's out of order, he said.
I got back in the truck. What's that? My mother asked.
What?
I said. That poison junk.
This is called food, I said, opening the bag of chips.
You can't eat that.
Yes, I can.
I put as big a handful of them as I could into my mouth. Swanna, you're really going to get fat.
I kept shoving handfuls of chips into my mouth until the man from New Jersey got back into the car.
I bought us lotto tickets, he said.
That's exciting, my mother said, even though we didn't believe in lotto tickets in our family.
I got 3 tickets and got them all with the same number, so if we win, we can share the prize.
That's fantastic, my mother said.
You got 3 tickets with the same number? I asked.
Yes, he said.
I could barely contain myself.
But you know that doesn't make sense.
Swanna, my mother said. It makes perfect sense.
Mom, he bought 3 tickets with the same number. If he'd picked 3 different numbers, we'd have 3 times the chance of winning.
But this way it's fair, the man said.
But we could have agreed to split all 3 tickets, I said.
I don't see what's wrong with what Borislav did, my mother said.
You're not being very gracious. I'm just saying it makes no sense.
Why not? The man asked.
Because we'd have 3 chances instead of 1, I said to my mother instead of him.
He didn't say anything, just started the truck up again and stared straight ahead at the road. There was a girl in my building named Indy who I idolized. She had a difficult stepfather. She went to the high school for performing arts for ballet. She was friends with me even though I was younger than she was. Once, she came to my house and moved her nose all around like Samantha and Bewitched. Then she laughed.
Okay,
she said.
Okay, what?
I said.
Your mom.
What?
She laughed again. It's just funny that they don't hide it.
Hide what? I said, having no idea what she was talking about. Marijuana?
What?
Pot, she said. Weed?
I didn't know what it was.
That smell, she said.
This. She walked over to our plants on the dining room windowsill.
These are marijuana plants, she said, laughing.
I don't think so, I said, furious.
Maybe I wasn't supposed to say anything.
No, you were, I had said.
The cab of the truck reeked of it now. And so did my mother. The man from New Jersey was drinking a beer, which he held between his thighs like a dick. I drank the tab,
which I had done without for almost the whole time I was away at camp, except when Jackie's parents took us to the Red Lion Inn, and when my dad had come to see me in the play. I thought about him waiting for me at the bus stop. I just had to get through this drive, and then I would be home. At this rate, we'd get home after midnight, but at least we'd get home. I couldn't wait to lie in my bed, even if it was at my mother's house, even if this man was there. My mother's bedroom was at the opposite end of the apartment from mine. I felt so sorry for my brother that he was going to have to leave camp and get into this truck.
Your mother's told me a lot about you, the man said.
He mumbled his words. He sounded like he was talking into a handkerchief. He sounded like a masked bank robber. I wish I could say the same, I said.
This is the happiest day of my life, my mother announced.
Introducing the two of you? Not the day I was born, or my brother was born. Not the day I starred as Katisha in the Mikado, or won the short story competition, or the day she married my father. This day. Mom, why didn't you write to me all summer? I was supposed to go home on the bus.
Your father didn't want you, my mother said.
What? I said, outraged. Yes, he did.
No, he didn't. He has a new girlfriend. I think it's one of his students.
How do you know that?
I asked him if I could have you and your brother, and he said yes. He was seeing someone. This is very important to me.
Well, going home was very important to me, I said.
When you were a child and we took you to London, you sat on the plane next to your brother and you said, I hope Madding and I won't ruin your trip. You used to be a very considerate child.
Usually the parents are concerned if the kids are having a good time, I said.
Belle? The driver said. Can I talk to you alone for a minute?
He pulled the car over to the side of the road again. Why are you stopping? I said. Most people don't have to pull over to talk. Most people can actually drive and talk at the same time.
It was going to be a very long trip if he pulled over every time he wanted to say anything.
Swanna, don't be rude, my mother said.
Val, do you mind if I talk to you over there?
He pointed to a tree and opened his door and got out.
I had to get out to let my mother out on my side. She tried to gracefully hop out of the truck, and I watched her tiny veined fingers grip onto the seat.
She pranced over to the tree with her sleeves billowing around her.
When they got back in, my mother said,
I would like very much for us to not quarrel and to try to get along.
We're going to have a wonderful time.
Chapter 3. We saw a diner, and miraculously my mother said we should stop. She and I sat across from each other in a booth by the window, which looked out at the truck. Whatever his name was had decided to stay in the truck and shut his eyes for a few minutes. I could have done with a different view.
What can I get for you? The waitress said. She was like Vera on the TV show Alice.
There's stuffed cabbage, I told my mother.
She couldn't ever order without me reminding her of what she would like. A chalkboard behind the counter said, stuffed cabbage in appealing handwriting.
Where do you see that? My mother asked, helplessly holding the huge menu.
There, I said, pointing to the sign. Stuffed cabbage, meatloaf, roast beef.
What's good? My mother asked, looking pleadingly up at the waitress.
The meatloaf is good, the waitress said. I sat back against the ripped vinyl booth and shook my head. My mother always asked waitresses and salesgirls opinions, which was one of the things I hated most about her. There was no way my mother was going to order the meatloaf. She would never order anything with meat in the title, or loaf for that matter. It would contain meat, but not be called meat. She would definitely order anything with cabbage, but we'd have to go through this whole song and dance with the waitress.
I don't eat meat, my mother said. I'll have the stuffed cabbage.
The stuffed cabbage has meat in it, the waitress said.
Yes, but I like that.
Stuffed cabbage, please.
You get two sides, salad, soup,
Peas, carrots, creamed corn, sauerkraut, red cabbage, french fries, mashed, baked, the waitress said. I closed my eyes because this was going to be excruciating. Sides? My mother said. Yes, sides, I said. Just choose two. Well, not mashed potatoes, my mother said. That's much too fattening. She looked pointedly at me. I love carrots, my mother said to the waitress. The waitress wrote down carrots. But I don't think I want carrots. I certainly don't want peas. I knew my mother wanted the red cabbage. Why don't you just order the red cabbage and the sauerkraut now, because that's what you're going to end up getting. She'll have red cabbage and the sauerkraut and the stuffed cabbage. All cabbage, I told the waitress. That's crazy, my mother said. I'll have a baked potato and carrots. The waitress wrote it down. No, my mother said. I'll have the red cabbage and the sauerkraut and the mashed potatoes. That's three sides, the waitress and I both said at the same time. And two of them are cabbage, I added. Oh, okay, no potatoes, my mother said. I have a new boyfriend. I cringed in my seat. I hear that, the waitress said. Mushroom or tomato sauce on the stuffed cabbage? She'll have tomato, I said. No, my mother said. Tomato. My mother wants tomato sauce, I interpreted. Mother, the waitress said. I braced myself for the usual, you look like sisters. Every single person said we looked like sisters. I thought you were the mother and she was your daughter. What? I said. This was worse than I had expected. You could be her daughter, she said to my mother. I looked at the waitress in disbelief. She's 30 years older than I am. I'm 14. You look great, she said to my mother. Thank you, my mother said, nodding. I ordered a chicken cutlet with mashed potatoes and peas. Don't scold me for asking this, but isn't that fattening? My mother said. It's not more fattening than the stuffed cabbage. There was nothing I hated more in this world than being told my mother looked like my sister, or now, my daughter, except for when my mother told me not to scold her. When she told me not to scold her, I wanted to take my knife and stab her to death in the diner booth. The two things she said that I hated the most were scold and quarrel. And if I told her not to scold me, she would say that she didn't want to quarrel. I tried to tell her that no one in 1982 used the word quarrel, but she didn't believe me. I knew quarrel was coming. Well, let's not quarrel, she said. You would look younger if you lost a few pounds and didn't wear that eyeliner. The man with the fake Russian name walked into the diner. Hello, he said. He smiled and did a little clownish bow and then ducked into the booth next to my mother. So I had to sit and face the two of them. This was worse than being in the truck. I wondered if someone watching us would think he was my brother. We already knew the waitress thought my mother was my daughter, but he really did look like her son. The waitress came and put the plates of food in front of us.
That looks tasty, the man said.
He reached behind him and grabbed a fork from the next table and held it in his fist like a bear. For the first time, I looked directly at his entire face instead of just his profile. He looked very familiar, like I had known him my whole life, but I couldn't put my finger on who he reminded me of. Maybe he was just from the neighborhood. Do you live on the Upper West Side? I asked.
No.
He looked like he had never heard of it. You look familiar to me, I said. He was too busy eating my mother's stuffed cabbage to answer me. Then he stopped eating and said,
would you please excuse me for a moment?
I just gave him a look, telling him I would excuse him for my entire lifetime.
I have to, use the facilities.
He got up, but walked in the opposite direction of the bathrooms. Then he walked right out the door. Where's he going? I asked my mother. I think he's going to the bathroom, she said defensively. What bathroom?
He doesn't like to go in public.
I looked out the window, trying to see what bathroom he was going to use. He's just walking into the woods, I said.
He probably wants to go in the woods where it's more private.
I said. Now I have started doing it. The woods is a public place. The restroom is private. He's going to poop in the woods instead of the bathroom? I was practically yelling. Don't say poop. He does what he wants.
I like that, my mother said. If he wants to make a do in the woods, that's his business. I think it's cool.
You don't like it when I do what I want.
Let me get this straight. The man just walked away from the men's room because he wants to shit in the woods. What is he going to use for toilet paper? A leaf? I don't know, my mother said. You're not being very nice. You're a very angry person.
When my mother said I was a very angry person, which she did constantly, I wanted to kill her all day long.
Is he claustrophobic? I asked,
thinking maybe he didn't want to lock himself into the privacy of a bathroom stall.
Why should he go into a smelly bathroom when he can be outdoors? My mother actually said.
She had never said a word like smelly in her entire life.
Be outdoors? He's going to take a shit in the woods. Like a homeless person?
Well, he is homeless, my mother said.
What? He doesn't want to live with his parents in New Jersey anymore because they're too Catholic. So after we leave Arcom...
What's Arcom? What do you mean after we leave Arcom? We're going home, aren't we?
It's the artist colony we're going to. We're staying there for 2 weeks.
I'm not staying there, I said, choking on my chicken. I'm going home.
It's a wonderful place for artists.
You said you just came from an artist colony, I said.
Yes, we were at Bread Loaf in Vermont. That's where I was. Borislav was a visiting artist. Now we're going to Artcom.
So you're going to two different artist colonies back to back? And the second one is in Vermont too?
Yes.
Vermont sounds like the most horrible place on earth, filled with freeloading, starving artists. That's probably why they call it Bread Loaf. All the artists think they'll get a sandwich.
Arcom is very prestigious. It's important. Borislav is nice enough to take us along. It's going to be like camp.
2 weeks? Mom, I said, that's impossible. School starts soon. What do you mean, like camp? Are there kids?
I'm trying to give you interesting experiences. We're going to be together.
What's he going to do at this art camp?
Artcom. He's going to make a very exciting sculpture out of hot tar.
Tar? Like they use for roads?
Yes.
What's he making a sculpture of? I asked.
A road, she said. And he's doing a series of Elvis Presley paintings.
That's when I realized who he looked like. Those square hurt lips and flat open cheeks.
Is he coming back in here?
Probably not for a long time. He might meet us at the truck. I should order something for him to go.
Are you going to pay for him?
This went against everything my mother had ever taught me.
He's going to be a famous artist one day, she said.
Chapter 4.
After the diner, my mother said that we were going to make a quick stop at Herman Melville's house. His name sounded familiar, and I was worried it was one of her boring poet friends. But then I realized I was thinking of Herman Bachman, who she taught with at Columbia. Then I realized that Herman Melville was the person who wrote Moby Dick. My mother knew a lot of famous authors, but I hadn't met Herman Melville yet. I was interested in meeting him mostly because my teachers were always very impressed when I mentioned that I knew the author of whatever book they were talking about. In fourth grade, I forced Arnold Lobel to come talk to my class. He wrote all the Frog and Toad books.
I think we should go straight to Madding, I said.
It was getting late, and no one had given me an answer on how long a drive it was to his camp.
It's a very small museum, my mother said.
That's when I knew Herman Melville was dead. I was very relieved I hadn't said anything about meeting him or asked if he had any kids.
I actually told Borislav we should stop there because I thought you would like it, my mother said.
I wouldn't, I said.
When we pulled into Herman Melville's driveway, a few people were gathered outside the door of a big house painted mustard yellow. I had to open the truck door to let my mother out, but I had no intention of going in.
Tour's starting, an old woman called over to us.
I started to get back in the truck.
What are you doing? My mother said.
I'm not going in.
We came here for you, my mother said.
We have to get matting.
You love whales, my mother said.
Are you joining us? The old lady called out.
Yes, my mother called back. The view from his office is a mountain that looks exactly like a sperm whale. That's how he had the idea to write Moby Dick. It was his inspiration.
If you know everything about it, then why are we here?
You have to pay homage, Swanna. For a writer, you're being disrespectful.
Actress, I corrected.
Who do I have to be respectful of?
Do you really think Herman Melville cares if I see his house?
Yes, I do, my mother said. I think he cares a great deal.
This was very typical of the kinds of arguments I had with her. They didn't make any sense. The old lady went inside, trailed by the tourists. My mother rushed in, and the man from New Jersey squished after her in his flip-flops. I got back in the truck and cranked down the window. I watched a tall blonde couple leave the gift shop, holding hands. They looked very romantic. He seemed grateful it was over, and she seemed grateful he had tolerated it. Maybe they were staying at the Red Lion Inn. I imagined them having sex in their room. Maybe they were on their honeymoon. I smiled, thinking that Madding would have really gotten a kick out of the word dick. I got out of the truck and walked around the house. I looked around, hoping to see the mountain my mother had told me about. Then there it was, looming in the distance above the trees. It really did look like a whale, a big blue whale hanging low in the sky. Melville's whale, a mountain that inspired him to write a book that made him famous. God had given him that mountain. Then I walked back to what God had given me. But all he had given me was Spermislav's truck. Yeah, call me Ishmael. The truck was mint green with splotches of rust. All the other cars around it looked normal. It was badly proportioned with a very long tail and a small body. The cab had a back window with three chrome bars across it. If you were in the cab, you couldn't see out the back because there was too much stuff blocking the window. On its side, the word custom was written in chrome script, surrounded by dots of rust, as if someone had tried to kill it by tossing a pot of tomato sauce on it. Inside, the seat was covered in...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.